Good morning. Good to have you all here today. Welcome to Christ Lutheran Church. We invite you, if you haven't already done so, to get all ready for worship as we begin. For those of you online, we welcome you here to Roanoke, Virginia, Christ Lutheran Church. We're gathered here today to celebrate this, the 17th Sunday after Pentecost. The bulletin, if you do not have one already, is found on our website, ChristLutheranRoanoke.org. Take a moment to download that and follow along, sing heartfully and loudly. And so we begin with our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who creates, redeems, and sustains us and all of creation.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Faithful God, have mercy on us. We confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We turn from your loving embrace and go our own ways. We pass judgment on one another before examining ourselves. We place our own needs before those of our neighbors. We keep your gift of salvation to ourselves. Make us humble, cast away our transgressions, and turn us again to life in you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God hears the cries of all who call out in need, and through his death and resurrection, Christ has made us his own. Hear the truth that God proclaims. Your sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Led by the Holy Spirit, live in freedom and newness to do God's work in the world. Amen. Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of love, giver of life, you know our frailties and failings. Give us your grace to overcome them. Keep us from those things that harm us, and guide us in the way of salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. This morning we'll have Donna Furrow read for us the 25th Psalm.
The first reading from Psalm 25, verses 1 through 9. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Do not let me be put to shame. Do not let my enemies exult over me. Do not let those who wait for you be put to shame. Let them be ashamed who are wantonly treacherous. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all day long. Be mindful of your mercy, O Lord, and of your steadfast love, for they have been from of old. Do not remember the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me. For your goodness' sake, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore, he instructs sinners in the way. He leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble his way. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And now, if the young people will come close. Come on, Denman, you can come up over here. Oh, don't need your chair. Come on, Denman. Come on. Come on, Landon. Come on, Gavin. Come on up here, right there. Right there. Come on. Landon, come on. We're waiting on you. Everybody's watching. The whole world is watching you, Landon. Okay, so I got a question for you guys. Today, the psalm that Donna just read talks about something that I kind of find hard to do, and that is being humble. Humble. Anybody know what humble means? What do you think it means, Denman? Be gentle? Yeah, that's a good way of putting it. Yeah, because when you're not humble, you can be like, oh, look at me. I don't care about anybody else. It's all about me and nobody else. And sometimes we all like to think about ourselves as being important, and we forget about others. And it's like Naomi. Look at her. She is crawling on her hands and knees to come forward today. What dedication. She is being humble, right? She's being humble. That's how she gets up here. And it's good that Landon let his sister lead her. That's the other thing, too, is that when we're not humble, we want to be in charge. We always want to be first in line. We want to get the best. We want everything. We want it for us and nobody else. But being humble means that we think of others. We think of others sometimes even before ourselves. Here's what it says. Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore, he instructs us in the way. He leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble his way. So, it's good to be humble. It's good to think of others and care about others around us. And in doing so, we follow in the way of Jesus. Let's pray. God, we give you thanks for showing us through the life of your Son, humbleness and gentleness. Help us, Lord, to be humble and care for others before ourselves. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Thank you all for coming up, guys. Come on, Naomi. All right, there you go, brother. Nope, nope. Yeah, that's the way. Nope. That's the way. Yep. And she likes it that way. Okay, very good. Good job. Good job. The gospel lesson for today comes to us from the 21st chapter of St. Matthew, beginning with the 23rd verse. When Jesus entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching and said, "By what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority?" Jesus said to them, "I will also ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will also tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin?" And they argued with one another, "If we say from heaven, he will say to us, 'Why then did you not believe in him?' But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the crowd, for all regard John as a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We do not know." And he said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work in the vineyard today.' He answered, 'I will not.' But later he changed his mind and went. The father went to the second and said the same, and he answered, 'I go, sir.' But he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father?" They said, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and prostitutes believed him. And even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And so we have before us today an understanding of authority. Well, what is authority? And how do we respond to someone in authority? What is authority to you? And who has authority in your life? A lot of times we confuse authority with power, but there is a difference. There is a difference. When the British wit G.K. Chesterton was dining with a literary friend in London one day, their conversation turned to the subject of power and authority. They were debating back and forth the differences, the nuances between power and authority. And at one point, Chesterton remarked, this is in my best high fluent British accent, "If a rhinoceros were to enter this restaurant now, there would be no denying he has great power here. But I should be the first to rise and assure him that he had no authority whatsoever." Power and authority. Power can be exerted by the use of force or violence. Authority, by contrast, depends on the acceptance of others, of subordinates, of the right of those above them to give orders or directives. Authority. Peter Marty, a Lutheran pastor and author, wrote in Christian Century back in 2016 about the social theorist Max Weber, describing power as having a coercive element and as authority as having a non-coercive one. "You can do what I ask of you because you have to do what I have the power to make you do, or you can do what I ask of you because you want to do it out of respect for who I am to you." The difference between the two motives is huge. A lifetime ago, in my other life as a club manager, I was managing a club in downtown Lexington, Kentucky. And just before the evening dinner shift, the sous chef, the second chef in command, injured his hand shucking oysters. Yes, you can hurt yourself doing that. And he had to go to the hospital for stitches and couldn't work that night. And we had a very, very full house. We had reservations for every moment, for every table throughout the evening. And so as the manager, I often oversaw the whole operation. I had a maitre d' that was in charge of the wait staff. I had a chef who was excellent. Sam Gardner was a good friend of mine, a great chef. He was in charge of the kitchen. And so I realized that I could make myself useful. Having grown up in commercial kitchens since I was 6 years old, I could step behind the line and help out and do the work of the sous chef that night. So I actually did. I had a white chef's uniform in my office at all time. I went in, put it on with the checkered pants, changed my shoes, went into the kitchen, and started to work the night shift, doing the best I could to help things go well. Well, near the end of the evening, there was a new dishwasher that the chef had just hired that day that it was obvious that this young fellow didn't really have a good attitude towards work. I heard him complaining all the time during that shift. This was his very first shift working in the kitchen, and he was just whining and complaining. Well, it got really busy, and I had some pots that needed to be cleaned, so I brought them to the dishwasher, and I said, I need you to clean these. I need them right away. And after a few expletive deleteds, including questioning the validity of my parents' marriage, he said to me, I'm not doing that. And I said, I'm going to ask you again. I need you to do this now. Well, who the heck are you? And then the chef, overhearing this, stood in front of me. Now, Sam Gardner was a great friend of mine from the hard side of Detroit. Sam was 6'7", weighed 395 pounds, and came up from the wrong side of the tracks. He stood in front of me, looked at the dishwasher, and then pointed to me, and he said, that man is the one who would have signed your paycheck. You're fired. Get out of here. Well, this poor guy started being very apologetic. It changed his whole attitude. I'll do the pots. I'll do them now. Once he realized who I was, it made all the difference. But why should it have? Because what I was asking was reasonable for him to do. And yet he questioned my authority because he didn't know me. That's understandable. And when he found out who I was the man whose signature would have been on his paycheck if he had stayed there, it changed the whole scenario. Well, in today's gospel, the Greek word here for authority, ekousia, it means not only the physical capability to do something, but also the right and authority to carry out the action. So the chief priests were not only concerned with what Jesus was doing, but by what authority he was speaking and healing and performing miracles. His credentials were being questioned, even if they could not question his actions and results. So Jesus turns the question back to them, and they balk, afraid of appearances and what the gathered people will think. Then he tells this little parable about reacting to a command. You heard it already. You've heard it before. The two sons are asked by their father to go. The first says no, but then thinks about it and does what he's asked. The second initially says, oh, yes, yes, I'll do it, but does nothing. Which one does the will of the father? It's obvious. The first one. Who actually takes what the father asks, takes it to heart, and then in time acts on that request. Well, how do you respond to the authority of Christ? Christ is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the Prince of Peace, the Lord of all. Christ is the only begotten one. Christ is our Savior and friend. And from my estimation and knowing Christ, Christ is the definition and ultimate example of authority. What is Jesus asking you to do this day? What is he asking you to do every day? What is his commandment? To love one another. as Christ has first loved us. That is the simple request, the simple demand, the simple command from Christ to love one another as Christ has first loved us. The awesomeness of this request is that Christ is not asking us to do something that he is not willing or hasn't already done. Christ is not expecting of us any less than he expects of himself to love one another. And he shows us the way. Humbleness is a characteristic of Christ. As the author of everything, he had ultimate authority. He could have come out of heaven on a flaming chariot, landed by the feet of the Pharaoh, and done anything he wanted. He could have expressed himself in front of Pilate and say, "I am the Alpha and the Omega. I am the beginning of the end. I am here since the dawn of time, and I command you." But no. Christ asks us from his heart in humbleness to love as he has loved us. He shows us what that love is. So how will you respond? How will you act? For the world is watching and waiting. The world is filled with people hungering and thirsting for love, for acceptance, for peace. How will you respond? Which of the two children will you be? The one who quickly says, "Oh, sure," or the one who does what God asks and love? Amen.
To bring
continue with the prayers of intercession. Drawn together in the compassion of God, we pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. In all the world, give your church unity. Inspire all the baptized with the mind of Christ, where the church is powerful and where it struggles. Shape us with humility and obedience so that your love may be at work in us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Your Son took on all of bodily life in our world, even to death. Preserve and keep your creation, O God. Mend and redeem places that are polluted and damaged so that all creation confesses you as Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Turn the nations toward life, where our ways are unfair. Give us new hearts and new spirits. Where sin permeates our cultures and institutions, change our minds and teach us to trust your authority. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Our lives are yours, O God. Relieve the suffering of those who are ill in body, mind, or spirit. Defend the lives and welfare of children who are abused or neglected, hungry or exploited, bullied or lonely. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Turn this congregation away from our own interests toward the interests of others. Fill us with your compassion and sympathy. Bless ministries of care in our community. We lift up especially the ministry of healing and wholeness. Be with the first responders and people in the front line of care during this COVID pandemic. Keep everyone in your sight. Impress upon us, Lord, the ability to care and to put others first. Make us into signs of your mercy and justice for our neighbors. We lift up the sick. We lift up Megan in need of healing, Lord. We lift up Mary in need of strength and continued healing. For all those in hospital, Bob and others, we ask you, Lord, to embrace them with your presence and your peace. Guide us, Lord, in your ways and in your mercy. Hear our prayer. All these things and whatever else you see that we need, we entrust to your mercy through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Also with you.
Share with one another a sign of God's peace. We continue with the great thanksgiving and the celebration of Holy Communion. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Holy, mighty, and merciful God, we give you fullest thanks and praise for heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. The gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. We give you thanks, gracious God, that you have once again fed us with food beyond compare, the body and blood of Christ. Lead us from this place, nourished and forgiven, into your beloved vineyard to wipe away the tears of all who hunger and thirst, guided by the example of the same Jesus Christ and led by the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Mother and God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you and lead you into the way of truth and life. Amen.
Thank you.